righty, good morning, everyone. Let me invite you, if you are in the lobby area, to come on and make your way into the worship center. Yes, we are still here. It is so good to be with you guys one last time. We're going to look at our final living giving principle this morning. So go ahead and open in your Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. So we're moving over to chapter 9. Let me give you a summary of what we've learned this week. Remember, before you and I give any of our material possessions to the Lord, He wants us to first give ourselves completely to Him. And then we learned on Tuesday night that I must be willing to be made materially poor if necessary in order that I or others may be made spiritually rich. And then we learned on Wednesday night that God wants me to learn to give out of that which I have. God's not asking us to give out of what we don't have, but He says, listen, look around, see what you do have, and then give out of that. And then we learned on Thursday night, I need to learn to give today out of my abundance to meet the needs of others, believing that tomorrow, if I have a need, God will use the abundance of others to meet my need. So here is our final living giving principle this morning. Giving must be according to the will of God. Giving must be according to the will of God. So we're going to be in our Bible, 2 Corinthians chapter 9. I'm going to begin reading in verse 1. Paul says, now it is superfluous for me to write to you about the ministry for the saints. For I know your readiness, of which I boast about you to the people of Macedonia, saying that Achaia has been ready since last year, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I'm sending the brothers so that our boasting about you may not prove empty in this matter, so that you may be ready as I said you would be. Otherwise, if some Macedonians come with me and find that you are not ready, we would be humiliated, to say nothing of you, for being so confident. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead to you and arrange in advance for the gift that you have promised, so that it may be ready as a willing gift, not as an exaction. Verse 6. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Notice Paul's wording here in verse 7. Paul says, one must give as he has decided in his heart. So at first glance, we look at this passage and it seems as if Paul is saying, listen, you think about what you want to give. You make a decision in your heart that you're comfortable with and you give that amount. But that's actually not at all what Paul is saying. That word decided there, it's only used here and it refers to a serious, lengthy consideration. This is this idea of deeply contemplating and mulling it over. And that actually leads to a decision that honors the Lord over honoring ourselves. So here's the question. How do you and I make sure that we're making a decision that honors God's will? Well, if you remember what we learned the very first day, they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us by the will of God. When you and I give ourselves first to the Lord, then we begin to understand God's will. So in order for you and I to know the will of God, I must be willing to let my will die. Turn to your neighbor and say, let it die. See, when I give myself completely to the Lord, something beautiful happens. My will begins to go away. Now notice what Paul says in the second part of the verse. He said, for God loves a cheerful giver. When you and I begin to give according to the will of God, we actually begin to understand joyful, cheerful giving. Now, the old country preacher said one time, God loveth a cheerful giver, but he'll taketh from a grouch. So whichever you want to be, but the God really desires that we give joyfully. So here's a few questions for us to wrap up our giving principles this morning. Have you studied what the Word of God has to say in relation to your giving? To which you would say, yes, we spent a whole week talking about giving and what God's Word says about giving. Question number two, are there any principles of God's Word that I may be violating in my giving? Well, here's the first one that we need to make sure we're honoring the Lord with. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all of your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. God desires that you and I give our first fruits to Him. That's the principle of tithing. We're all aware of that. Now listen to me, church. If you and I, as believers, not lost people, but as believers, if we're not giving our tithes to the Lord, we're actually robbing God. We're thieves. And so I would challenge you. If I get it, it's scary to do that. You're like, I don't know if I can trust God. Listen, after many, 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 many years of trusting the Lord with my finances, I promise you, you can trust Him. Next question. Is there something God has told you to give in the past that you have not obeyed? We were at a conference one time, and one of our revivalists got a knock on their trailer. He opened the door, and there's a lady standing there, and she says, "Hey, are you here with the Life Action team?" He said, "Yes, ma'am." She said, "Can I have a conversation with you?" He said, "Sure." She said, "Several years ago, one of your teams was at our church. We live about an hour and a half, 2 hours away. And your team was at our church, and God told me to give, and I disobeyed the Lord." And she says, "For the last 2 or 3 years, it has eaten me up from the inside out." And she said, "So I drove 2 hours just so I could obey the Lord and give what He told me to give." Next question. Are you willing to obey any direction from God in relation to your giving? We were in New Lenox, Illinois, not too long ago, and this is what Jeff and Lisa had to say. God asked us for trust in Him. He asked us to put an offering envelope in our Bible and pray for what God might have us to do. And we did just that. We put our gift in the box, and before we left that night, our pastor handed us an envelope. It was a gift of money from a group of church members. You see, they knew that 3 weeks earlier, my wife had been robbed. And God honored our giving with a gift to restore a portion of our loss. We are truly blessed by our congregation. They followed their heart, led by God's Spirit, and we followed our heart, led by God's Spirit. Now, here's a portion of that story that they didn't tell. His wife had been robbed, but what she was doing, she was on her way to the bank to deposit the payroll of their business. And she was robbed. And so it wasn't just their financial situation that was affected, all of their employees, because now they didn't have payroll to pay their employees. And so they gave out of their need, just like the Macedonian people did. They gave out of their need. So as we wrap up these giving principles, I want you to see that God will actually honor your obedient, abundant, generous giving. Let's look at the rest of the passages in your Bible there. Look at beginning of verse 8. "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work." As it is written, he's going to quote Psalm 112, verse 9. "He has distributed freely. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever." Verse 10, "He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God." Paul says, listen, guys, God will provide a way for you to be faithful and abundant in your giving. And I know, again, it's hard to trust God with your resources. And in that statement is the problem. They're not your resources. They're God's resources. And I promise you, He wants to take care of the resources. Here's what you and I need to realize. We cannot take it with us, but we can send it on ahead. And God gives us the ability to send it on ahead. I want to invite you to stand with me this morning. The team is going to lead us in some worship, and we're going to worship the King together, and then we'll have another teaching.
Let's sing this together. I count.
I count on one thing.
The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Provided and Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto
me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love.
Great is. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. That endureth, thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings, oh my, with 10,000 beside. And great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. And I have needed, thy hand has provided, and great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
And Lord, we rejoice in the promise in your word that you are always with us. Lord, I thank you that we have a comforter in you through your Spirit. Lord, I pray that your comfort and your kindness would lead us to repentance. Father, would you reveal to us the knowledge of your will and come and be a part of our service. Move in power and might again this morning, God. You are so faithful to us. In Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, team. All righty. Before you sit down, I want you to go find somebody, tell them good morning, give them a hug.
Shane.
All righty. Let's make our way back to our spot. Good morning. Oh, that wasn't for me? Okay. All righty. Well, guys, we want to look at our final teaching this morning for our Sunday morning time. We've been on a journey this week, right? We've been climbing the summit, seeking the reviver of our souls. We began last Sunday morning looking at the holiness of God. Who is this God that we claim to serve? And then how will we respond to Him? And so we began Sunday night looking at the honesty of the that the Lord was required of us. And we took that wonderful test in the back of our booklet that revealed a lot about us, didn't it? It was a hard test. How many of you passed that complete spiritual? Yeah, me either. Right? I've taken it several times. And then Monday night, we dealt with the pride in our hearts, and we cried out for God to give us the humility that we desperately need. We made a decision in that moment to say, Lord, I humble myself fully and completely before You. And then Tuesday night, we discussed our need for the grace of God. We cried out, God, I need You. The same grace that saves us is the same grace that sustains us. God gives us all we need to obey Him. And then Wednesday night, many of you came forward and you chose as an act of your will to forgive a hurt that that you had suffered. And you said, Lord, I don't want to be in that prison anymore. And then Thursday night, many of you walked around, encouraged, loved on one another, and some of you very likely went and sought forgiveness for how you hurt someone else. And some of you came and told me those stories and how hard that was for you to do, but how gracious God was to you. So tonight, or this morning, we're going to continue on our journey of saying yes to God. So I want you to open in your Bible to Acts chapter 8. Your next yes to God. Here's our revival truth. By the way, it's page 18 in your workbook as well. Acts chapter 8 in your Bible, page 18 in your workbook. Here's our revival truth. When we are living a revived life, saying yes to God becomes our passion. When we're living a revived life, our yes to God becomes our passion. Luke chapter 22, verse 42, Jesus, not my will, but yours be done. Jesus was demonstrating for us the yieldedness that He asked of us to give as well. So Acts chapter 8, we're going to begin reading in verse 26. When you got it, say, I got it. All righty. Acts chapter 8, beginning in verse 26. I'm going to read from an English Standard Version. You follow along in whatever version you have. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, rise and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place. And he rose and went. And there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, a queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning, seated in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And the Spirit joined this chariot. So Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I, unless someone guides me? And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this. Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before its shearer is silent, so opens not his mouth. In his humiliation justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. And then the eunuch said to Philip, about whom, I ask you, does the prophet say this, about himself or about someone else? And then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with the scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. And as they were going along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, see, here's water. What prevents me from being baptized? And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. So as we read this passage, we see this man that was living in obedience to the Lord, said yes to the Lord. So my question to you this morning is, are you ready for your next yes opportunity. How can you and I actually know that we're ready to say yes to God at His next calling? When I was in practice and we would kind of get off track in our business, I would always bring my staff together and we would talk about going back to the basics. See, the answer to staying on course was always found in the basics. And so tonight, or this morning, I want us to just take just a moment and just go back to the basics. If you and I are going to be faithful to God's next calling on our lives, if we're going to be faithful to say yes to Him, there's a few things that are going to be needed in our lives. Number one, we're going to have to be faithful to the Lord by being available. We're going to have to be alert and sensitive to the voice of God. We're going to have to be fearlessly obedient to God's prompting. We've got to make sure we're students of the Word of God. We've got to be filled with the Spirit, and we've got to be dependent upon the Spirit. So we're going to talk about those things tonight. I gave you all my points in the beginning, okay? Here's our first point. You and I must be available to God. Notice verse 26. It says, "Now the angel of the Lord said to Philip, 'Rise and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.'" Now let me paint a picture a bit for you of what's going on here. If we back up to chapter 7, Stephen has been stoned, and then we see in Acts chapter 8, verse 1, there's a great persecution that arose against the church. So all the churches scattered, and Saul, which will soon become Paul, Saul is going house to house, and he's wreaking havoc upon all the believers. Look at chapter 8, verse 4. It says, "Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word, and Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip, and when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in the city." So get this. Bad things begin to happen to the church, right? So all the people of the church decided to run and hide. Is that what's happening? They decided to get themselves so wrapped up in conspiracy theories. They decided to divide themselves over politics or a piece of paper over the face or a shot in the arm. Is that what happened? No, not at all. Look at verse 4. They went everywhere preaching. Things got tough, and the tough got going. Listen, the scattered church is more effective for the kingdom of God than the gathered church. God wants to do such a work in your heart that you're no longer a gathered church, you're a scattered church. You're out telling people about the Jesus that saved you. And we find that Philip was busy doing the Lord's work. He was preaching in Samaria. Philip was busy doing the Lord's work, and he was available for whatever it was that the Lord wanted to do next. Let's think about this for just a moment. Philip was preaching Christ. The people in Samaria were listening. They were gathered together in multitudes. They were paying attention to everything that he was saying. And when Philip spoke, great things were happening, and the verse says there was great joy in the city. So in the midst of great persecution, God sends a portion of revival to Samaria. Large crowds were coming together, listening. There was joy. And then suddenly, God changes Philip's marching orders. Look at verse 26. God says, "Go south to the road, the desert road that no one goes down." That road from Jerusalem to Gaza. God says, "Get up and go down that road that's rarely used." There were two roads, and Philip was to take the one less traveled. Philip was doing good things. He was working for the Lord. He was preaching the gospel. God was moving greatly in the hearts of his people, but God had something else in mind. God was doing a work in the multitude, but he wanted Philip to rise and go because of one man. Here's the principle I want us to learn this morning. We must be careful not to allow our good work for the Lord to get in the way of his best work for us and for his kingdom. That's something I've really seen about First Baptist Church in the last week. You guys do a lot. You are servants. I mean, there are people that basically live here at the church. They're like here all the time. I'm like, do you ever go home? Is like a couch you have somewhere, right? Right, that you sleep on? They live here. You guys are like here all the time. You work really well. But be careful not to let your good work get in the way of the best work that God has for you and for his kingdom. Did you know that the Lord always has his very best in mind for his children? Philip was available and ready to go in spite of what the Lord was busy doing where he was, simply because the angel of the Lord spoke to him and said, "Arise and go." So let me ask you this morning, are you too busy in your ministry? Are you too busy doing really good stuff, stuff that God wants you to do, that it would be difficult for the Lord to pull you away for something that doesn't seem as important or as worthy of a task? You see, guys, I think if we're not careful, we can get so busy doing what God has called us to do that we can miss doing what God is calling us to do next. When's the last time you heard God change your marching orders? Would you be available to go? Would you be willing to trust God even though it didn't seem to make sense to your finite minds? See, we have no idea what God has in store for us if we're available to him, if we're listening. Did you know the Ethiopian eunuch very likely was the man that introduced Christianity to all of Ethiopia, to all of Africa? One man, potentially, because Philip was obedient. Are you available today? I remember when I began to announce that God was calling me out of full-time practice. My practice was a ministry. We prayed over our patients. We loved on them. We developed deep relationships. And I'll never forget when I began to announce that God was calling me into full-time ministry to become a missionary, how many people told me I had lost my mind. There's no way it could be God's will. God wouldn't call you away from such a blessed season of your life. Are you sure this is what God's calling you to do? You're so gifted in this. You got to be missed. And I had to stand on the confidence of the call of God. Philip was available, but Philip was also sensitive. You and I must be sensitive to the voice of God. Look at verses 27 and 28. And he rose and went, and there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure, who had come to Jerusalem to worship. And he was returning, seated in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Philip received a message from the Lord. So look what the Bible says. He rose and went. I love that, church. Listen, there was no question. There was no negotiation. Philip knew that it was time to move. Why? Because he knew that God had spoken. Philip had seen God work before. Listen to me, church. The more you and I obey God, the more we recognize the voice of God. The more we obey God, the more we recognize the voice of God. If you're one of the people, you're like, I just don't ever hear God's voice. It may be because you're living in some area of disobedience. You start obeying him, and you'll have such a confidence when he speaks into your heart. See, Philip knew that the Lord was up to something, even though it probably didn't make a lot of sense to him at the time. The Lord pulled Philip away from the multitude to travel that lonely, deserted road for one Gentile, one non-Jew, one not-so-special person. Now, I like to put myself right in the middle of God's stories. Put yourself in Philip's shoes for a moment. You're traveling down this lonely road, as you've been instructed to do, and I'm sure that Philip was having a conversation with the Lord. I know that I would have been having a conversation with the Lord. In my imagination, the conversation would go something like this. You know, God, big things were happening back there in Samaria. People were coming by the multitudes, Lord. Did you see all our decision cards, Lord? Your kingdom was growing. Lord, we were having spontaneous baptisms, Lord. Did you not notice what was happening, Lord? So he's talking with God. And I am sure that he had no clue what to expect when suddenly this entourage of people comes toward him. Can you put yourself in the story with Philip today? I think Philip probably at that point started smiling at the Lord. Okay, God, I see. You're good, God. You're good. I didn't understand it, but there you are. See, God in his sovereignty had created a divine appointment for the eunuch and for Philip. Now, what would have happened if Philip had not been available and sensitive to the voice of God? Well, we don't know. Why? Because he was. Philip was available and Philip was sensitive. A few years ago, we were doing a conference in Hayden, Alabama. You met Ricky and Susan the other night. They're from Hayden. We were doing a conference in Hayden, Alabama, and I brought in a reference with me. He was doing the family material for me that week, and his name is Tom Nesbitt. And Tom is in his late 80s, and he's been pastoring since he was 15. He started pastoring a small church at the age of 15. And Tom was one of these guys that he never meets a stranger. If you ever meet Tom, he's going to ask you what your name is, and then he's going to tell you what your name means, and then he's going to ask you what your birthday is, and he's going to tell you the proverb of your life and the psalm of your life. Every single time, he's going to do it. How does he know what all those names mean? I have no clue. Sometimes I think he makes it up. But he tells everybody their name. And so Tom and I were at the Huddle House right off of the interstate, I-65, having some breakfast together. And there was a lady there picking up a to-go order. And Tom, being true to course, walked up to her and he says, "Ma'am, what's your name?" Her name was Joanne. And Joanne began to, as Tom was interacting with her, asking her questions, she began to interact with us, and she began to tell us the story of her life. And she told us about her son. Her son named Jalen. Her son was in the psychotic ward of the prison. He had done some really bad things. She was asking us to pray. And she had her son with her. His name was Dimitrik. And I remember as Tom was having the conversation with Joanne and Dimitrik was watching on, looking up at his grandmother, I was looking at the two of them, and I noticed something pretty interesting. Joanne had a shirt on that said, Romans 14:11, every knee will bow. Well, Dimitrik had a shirt on as well. And Dimitrik's shirt said this, if you are mean to me, you better run, because my cat after you, and she is bringing hell's fury. And so I'm looking at those two shirts, and I'm seeing quite a dichotomy. Every knee will bow, hell's fury. What's going on here? And I'm processing this as Tom is having the conversation. And so they finished their conversation. Tom prayed with them, and she walked off. And I said, Tom, did you notice those shirts? He goes, no, I didn't. I said, his grandmother said every knee will bow. His said talked about hell's fury and that she would come after him or that she would come after anybody that messed with her grandson. And Tom said, now listen, the whole conversation that Tom's having, the Spirit of God is saying, Shane, talk to her about the dichotomy you see. Tell her. Explain that. And I'm like, I don't want to interrupt Tom. God, he's 80-something years old. Have you ever interrupted Tom? That's the conversation I'm having with the Lord. And so I get through and I tell Tom about it. He goes, why didn't you say something? And I knew I'd missed the prompting of God. So I got up and I ran outside, and Joanne and her grandson Dimitrik was already gone. I missed an opportunity of the Lord because I wasn't sensitive to the voice of the Lord. Now, Philip may have been hesitant at first because the traveler that's coming toward him is this obvious person of considerable importance. The Bible says that he was the treasurer of Candace's money. He would be like the Secretary of Treasury today in our world. Or maybe Philip may have feared being a little snubbed. I believe that this could have been very possibly been an uncomfortable situation for Philip. However, regardless of how things may have looked to him, I think that he was so sensitive to the leading of the Spirit of God that there was no doubt in his mind that he was to minister to this individual. And here's the beautiful thing. This individual, this unit, was ready to hear about Jesus. It was a perfect moment for Philip and a perfect moment for the eunuch. Now, we've all been there. You're at that Walmart checkout line. And everybody in front of you has a lot in their buggy. You've got a lot in your buggy. It's lunchtime, and you're ready to get out of there. You finally get up to the time where the person is scanning your items, and it's like every time you're at Walmart, they're like, beep. Beep. And you're like, woman, you got to hurry. Right? I got to go. And then the Spirit of God reaches up from the inside, taps you on the shoulder, and says, Doc, time to share the gospel. God, are you kidding me? I got an appointment with Byron. You ever been late to an appointment with Byron? No, God. Lord, I don't know if I'm going to know what to say. Lord, this is not the right time. Lord, what are you talking about? It's time to minister. God has something that he wants you to do, and there's no doubt in your mind, but all of a sudden you start coming up with a list of excuses of why you can't do what God wants you to do. God, I didn't have a quiet time this morning. God, you know our intimacy is strained right now. God, I'm not worthy to minister to this person. But see, what you and I fail to realize is that God very well may be allowing you in this moment to witness him at his best. In order for you and I to do what God calls us to do in this moment, we've got to be sensitive to his voice so that we don't miss the yes opportunity. Guys, listen to me. There's no other way. And God's not expecting you to come up with something to say. God's expecting you just to yield to your will so that his will can be done. Just like the Lord had created a divine appointment for Philip and the eunuch, he creates them for you and me every day. And we've got to be sensitive to his voice. And you know, God may put you in some very difficult divine appointments and circumstances. And we got to be careful not to despise the circumstances of life, because it's in these circumstances that God is at work to fulfill his kingdom purpose and to grow us in him. Philip was available. Philip was sensitive. And we also see that Philip was obedient to God's command. And you and I must be obedient to God's command. Look at verses 29 through 31. And the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over and join this chariot." And so Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he said, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And invited Philip to come up and sit with him. You see, because Philip was sensitive to God, because he had seen God work before, he was able to approach this journey with great boldness. Verse 30 says, "So Philip ran." Again, I love this. There was no argument from Philip, no discussion with the Lord, no question, no rationalizing, no debating. It just says, Philip ran. I wonder, had I been there in that moment, if my response would have been so sudden and drastic that I ran to that chariot. I remember God calling me into full-time ministry. I was sitting right back there in the worship center. The preacher was up preaching, much like I've been doing all week. And God made it very clear to me that he was calling our family to be full-time missionaries. And we said yes to the Lord that night. And then some days later, I was at our local Mexican restaurant. La Parrilla was the restaurant. And I saw one of my colleagues in the restaurant. And so I went over to say hey to him, and he says, "Hey, man, I hear that you feel like you're being called to full-time ministry." I says, "I am." He said, "I just want to say congratulations to you." And I said, "Thank you," shook his hand, and then I turned away to walk back toward my table, and I was absolutely ticked off. I was furious, and my conversation went this way to the Lord: "Are you kidding me, God? You're telling me to walk away from everything, and that guy that's not following you is going to still fly wherever he wants to fly, drive that nice sports car, live in that nice house, go on those scuba diving trips, do all those wonderful things, and you're telling me to walk away from every bit of that? That's not fair." That was my conversation with the Lord. And then I'll never forget laying in my bed having my God-ordained Sunday nap. By the way, if you missed that, you're out of God's will. So I'm joking. So I'm laying in my bed looking up at my ceiling fan as it's spinning. And I remember saying, "You know, Lord, we could sell our house. We could cut back on our expenses. And we could start giving more than we're already giving to the kingdom of God. We could bless people beyond measure. They'll be blessed. They'll be able to serve you. I'll be blessed because I'm giving. You'll be blessed because they're enlarging your kingdom. Lord, it'll be wonderful. It'll be a win-win. And then the Lord gave me a picture of what my family would look like if I chose my will over his will. It was a hard thing to do, but God was calling me to it because he saw me, he knew me, and he loved me. I debated with God, not Philip. Run, Philip, run. Apparently the compulsion of the Spirit of God was unmistakable to Philip. Now, why was Philip's immediate obedience so important? It wasn't that he might miss the traveler, he might miss the text. Verse 28 says, the Ethiopian was sitting in the chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. Once again, a sovereign work of God. The Spirit had given this man a desire to seek God. God had been working in the secret places of his heart. Do you think that that eunuch just happened to be reading the Old Testament passage by chance? Think about this. This man was traveling like 120 days round trip to worship God. He was searching for the very God that had sovereignly put him on that lonely, deserted road at that very specific moment. The Holy Spirit knew just how far the eunuch had put Isaiah. He knew that he had come to what we would call chapter 53 today. He knew just how far down that strategic chapter that he had progressed. He knew just what soul-searching questions were welling up inside the Ethiopian's heart. Why? Because he had put the questions there. And at just the right moment, as Philip made his way to Gaza, this man was reading aloud the gospel and desiring to understand what he was reading. Run, Philip, run. Listen, there are times when the business of the king calls for haste on our part. And this particular incident illustrates the magnificent timing of God and the faithful obedience of a man of God. A man that was willing to say yes. Listen, had it not been for Philip's faithful yes to God, the eunuch would have not gotten to see the sovereign work of God. Not only did the Lord provide perfect timing for Philip, it was also perfect, it was a perfect opportunity. What do I mean? There was no way that Philip could have ran up to this high official's chariot. Again, the eunuch was compared to like the Secretary of State. So he was traveling in style. And Philip was able to run up to the chariot. Philip wasn't a very important person. He wasn't dressed in royal robes as he approached the chariot. He was just a simple, common man. And so God had to sovereignly create an opportunity of meeting. And as it was at this moment, the eunuch was brought to the perfect point of desperation, longing with all of his heart to know the living God and to submit himself to his revelation. And Philip was right there because of his availability, because he was sensitive to the voice of God, and because of his fearless obedience. So again, I've got to ask myself, and you, as an act of obedience, will I be right there willing to say yes when God creates a next yes opportunity for me, or for maybe for someone else through me? We've got to be available. We've got to be sensitive to the voice of God. We've got to be ready to obey. And then we have to have a living knowledge of God's word. We see in verses 32 through 35 what the eunuch was reading. And Philip had to know God's word. Imagine as Philip heard that glorious passage of Isaiah 53 read, the Bible says he opened his mouth and beginning from the scripture, he preached Jesus to him. And he asked this question, do you understand what you're reading? And at once this educated man, this eunuch, confessed his perplexity. He had no trouble understanding the words, but he had a considerable trouble understanding the message of the words. And because Philip was a student of the scriptures, he was able to use the scripture when God called him to the task. Listen to me, church. This is going to sound like one of those duh statements in church, and it is, but we must be students of this book. We've got to spend time in the Bible. We can't know about the Bible because the man of God preaches the Bible. We've got to know. We're a people that says, I believe every word. This is the inerrant, inspired word of God. I believe every bit of it, but we hold it out here. We don't hold it. Spend time reading it. Many of you have been saved for 45, 50 years, and you've never read this book from front to cover. From cover to cover, from front to back. Never. You've never read the whole book. You see, we're a group of people that will drive across town to sit under the preaching of the Word of God, but we won't get up and walk across the living room to pick up the Word of God. For some of us, if we're honest this morning, we got ready for church this morning, we're like, where did I leave my Bible? I don't remember where it was when I left last Thursday. Right? There are so many things creatively battling for our attention with a solidary intent of causing us to neglect God's divine revelation. You know, we'll spend our time and our energy on the things that we're devoted to. So the question that we must be willing to ask ourselves this morning is, what am I devoted to? Take your copy of God's Word out this morning and just kind of thumb through it. Just look in the pages. Maybe this is a new Bible for you. You've only had it for a short while. If that's the case, here's a disclaimer for you. It's a new Bible. But if it's a Bible that you've had for a long time, are the pages still white? Are they still stuck together? Or are they yellow, stained by the oils of your fingers and the tears of your eyes? Have you spent time with God in His Word? Do you have a living knowledge of the Word of God? Does it come alive to you? Do you get excited as you read God's love letter to you? So here's the bottom line. If you and I are students of the Word of God, then we'll be ready to use God's Word when He calls us to task. We also see that Philip was willing to trust God. Look at verses 36 through 39. And as they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized?" And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away. I'm waiting for that moment. I get through my message, and the Spirit of God just moves me on to the next place. Like, make it happen, Lord. Wouldn't that be exciting? See, the task that God had called Philip to was successful, not because of Philip, but because of the working of the Spirit of God in his life. See, Philip knew that his only responsibility was to preach Jesus to this man. He didn't have to perform some great spiritual movement within the life of this man. It was not his responsibility to save the eunuch. It wasn't his responsibility to create another move of God, another revival, if you will. He was, however, responsible to be faithful to the Lord and let the Lord take care of everything else. See, so many times we avoid opportunities created by God because we feel like we have too much pressure upon ourselves. It's our responsibility to do all the work in this encounter. And it's not. God just wants us to open our mouth and be faithful to Him to tell our story of how God changed us. It's like we have this idea that everything is up to us. And if something big doesn't happen, then it's our fault. Now, we do have a responsibility. But listen, I'm going to tell you your full responsibility before the Lord. You ready? It's this simple. Surrender and obey. That's it. That's all God called you to do in this life. Surrender to Him and obey Him. If you want to see tremendous growth take place in your life, if you want to see God glorified, here's what you need to do. Place yourself in the hands of God. Most important thing that you could do in your life. And listen, church, God may not be calling you to do something really big like pack up your house and live on church parking lots in an RV. He may be calling you just to go to your neighbor, knock on their door, and tell them that Jesus loves them and that you love them. It may be that He's just asking you to go and repent before your friend because you've hurt them. It may be that He's just asking you to serve in some spot in the church, sing in the choir, serve in nursery, teach a Sunday school class. Here's what He's asking you to do. He's asking you to say yes. God's not asking you to be obedient to a calling. He's asking you to be obedient to Him. I'm going to invite the team to come up. Here's my question for you. Are you ready for your next yes? Are you available to God? Are you making sure that you're sensitive to the voice of God? Remember, we hear the voice of God by obeying Him. Are you willing to be obedient to the command of God? Bold, radical obedience. Do you have a living knowledge of the Word of God? Do you spend time with Him in His Word so that His Word is written upon the tablet of your heart? See, God wants you to spend time in His Word so that you're ready for what He has for you to do. And then finally, are you willing to trust Him? Big God, little me. Here's what I want to invite you to do this morning. I want you to take some time, just close your eyes right where you are. And I want to invite you to just kind of put your hands in your lap with your palms up. It's a posture of receiving. And it's also a posture of yielding. So I'm giving everything I have to you, Lord. I'm trusting you for whatever it is that you want to give me. And right there where you are, I want you to just have a conversation with the Lord. And maybe you'll ask Him this, Lord, what would it look like if I said yes to you? And Lord, would you give me the grace to say yes with every area of my life? Would you just spend some time just right there, just you and the Lord, no one else is in the room. Have a conversation with Him, and then I'll complete our time together. Just a moment, the team is going to lead us in a song. You've heard the song a few times this week. It's Nothing Else. Here's what I want you to do. As the team leads us and you reflect on your conversation with the Lord, I want to invite you, if you feel like you can, this morning, to write a blank check to God. Here's what you're doing. You're writing God a blank check, and you're signing your name saying, Lord, whatever you ask me to do, whenever you ask me to do it, my answer is yes. So essentially what you're doing is you're saying, God, I trust you, not myself. Now, it may be that you have to say, Lord, you know me better than I do. And I'm making this commitment, but I'm desperately going to need your grace. Because I know I love me oftentimes so much more than I love you. So if you feel like, as the team is singing, if you feel like that you can write a blank check to God, saying, Lord, whenever, however, whoever, whatever, my answer is yes, Lord. I'm telling you yes. Before I even know what the question is. If you feel like you can do that as the team sings, I'm going to invite you to stand as a symbol of your obedience. But listen to me careful. Don't trifle with God. Don't trifle with Him. If you can't say yes to him, I would encourage you just to stay seated. But I pray that you can trust him. I can tell you from a life, you can. You can trust him. He's a perfect gentleman. I'm going to pray for you. The team is going to lead. And do you feel like you can say yes to the Lord? I'll invite you to stand. Father, I thank you for this church family. You've taken us on a journey this week for one purpose, to transform us more into your image and to give us an opportunity to yield ourselves to you. You're calling us to our next yes. Maybe big, maybe small, but you want us to say yes. So will you give your people the grace to trust you? And with a heart of full and complete abandonment, say yes to you. May it be so, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Caught up in your presence. Oh, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sing another song. Will take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry, I forgot that you're enough. Oh, take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. Oh, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. King Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that I can do, I just want you. Well, I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Oh, nothing else will do. I just want you. Oh, nothing else. Oh, nothing else. Nothing else will do. And I just want you. Nothing else. Oh, nothing else. Oh, nothing else. Else will do, die just to honor you. Oh, nothing else. Oh, nothing else. Nothing else will do. And I'm caught up in your presence. Oh, I just want to sit here at your feet. And I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. And though I'm not here for blessing, Jesus, you don't owe me anything. Oh, more than anything that can do, I just want you. And more than anything that I just want you.
I want to pray for all of you that have stood this morning, but listen to me. Let me give you some counsel. God will test you in your obedience. It may be today. It may be big. It may be small. But He will test you in your obedience. If you want to say yes to me, here's what He's going to do. Here's an opportunity for you to do so. Father, will you give your people great grace as you call them, maybe in the next several moments, to say yes to you? And Lord, will you help them to see what an exciting adventure you have in store for them? Because you see them, you know them, and you love them. In Jesus' name, amen. We've got about a 23-minute break. We'll start right back up at 10:30 sharp. All right, go get you a cup of coffee, whatever. Use the restroom. We'll see you at 10:30.
When the silence steals my voice, you understand me.
So I stop all negotiations. last upon